Greetings in the Lord Jesus. John said that he would baptize us with the Holy Spirit and fire. And so we are humbled and we are grateful and we are empowered by the Holy Spirit. It's always a time that I look forward to join you. And it's an honor to spend this time with you. So I thank you for allow me to come into your private time and listen to just a ordinary vessel that tries to relay what the Lord has taught me and what I have studied over the last four decades through the scriptures of Hebrew and Chaldean and Latin, Aramaic, Greek, and so many others. I may not pronounce the words, but I do read them and understand them, along with many of the rabbis. So today, let me welcome in our wisdom warriors. I am so grateful for you and thankful for you. Your prayers are needed not only for me, bringing truth to the body of Christ, but for the body of Christ. And we need it for the great eagle, the United States of America. And I know that you pray for, as I do, and my family, Kimberly and Luke, for the body of Christ around the world. It's a difficult time for many. So today, as I normally do, for people, we have people, new ones joining us from all over. And I want to thank the person in Jordan that sent a note. I don't get a chance to read very many of them, Luke and Kimberly, and they handle that for me. But you want to reach us, National War Council for Prayer, Post Office Box 931. Argyle, Texas, 76226. And this past week, I hope and pray that you went and did not only to listen to what was presented, don't be hearers only, but be doers of the word. And that is, I'll talk about the Bereans in a little while, and I'm so grateful for true Bereans. The Lord told me this past week, we were at night during my private time. He said there is Bereans, true Bereans within the ecclesia or the ecclesia, not so much in their structural church, but there are ones that, as the Bereans, and I've been asked before, that what are Bereans? They were in the book of Acts that Paul talked about. They heard something new. They heard something entirely different, and we'll talk today about mysteries. And it challenged their tradition. It challenged their thought process. It challenged their doctrine. So they would go home each night, and they would study. And they would come back, and they would ask questions, and Paul would go through it with them from the Old Testament, everything in the Torah and the Pentateuch. So, but this past week, I was praying and for the Bereans, those that study, and those that are hearing something that they may not have heard before. As I've said, I just ask you, when I present studies and facts in Hebrew and Greek and Chaldean, and it's supported in scripture and in one of my areas, I don't know which one to point at with a camera, the Strong's Concordance, but in Hebrew, a lot of the Old Testament, and I've said this before, and you know, a lot of what I say, the mainstream doesn't care for, but Judaism can exist without Christianity, but Christianity cannot exist without Judaism. The Torah, the Pentateuch, the Old Testament, and then my best friend and savior and high priest and king, he's a Jew. He was a Jewish carpenter, you know, with his stepfather, Joseph. So we'll get further into that. But I wanted to show a picture of this one. He knows I've been studying the Constitution and the prophetic words that the Lord has been given to me over and over these last few months about the United States. And I hope to be able to release some of that soon. But this is from the scholar. He sent it to me the other night. Of the great eagle lifting the Declaration of Independence, we the people, out of where those that do not like this country, of socialism and communism and others that have tried to take over the nation have tried to burn the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, the amendments, First Amendment, Second Amendment. But this is, the Lord is going to raise this up again and be the standard. The world, those nations, they hate us because not only the democracy that we have, this experiment we call the United States of America for 200 years, which was God-given, a divine founding by God. So for men, it was an experiment, but not in God's mind and not in my heart. He always knew that the United States of America would be there. But they hate us also because of the gospel of Jesus Christ and our Judeo-Christian values. So let me cover just a few things of what I did in part one. I won't go through all of those. We talked about the tree, and I gave the prophetic word. This part will be, I include them each time in notes so that I can send them to Greg, and he can, with each part, the notes will be in there. So they were in there from part one. We talked about water baptism, and I gave you the Greek word for water baptism. Was Greek 908, and it's used 22 times, and part of that in Greek is immersion in water. And I know that this past week we have received a lot of emails and questions, and I will try to answer legitimate questions, genuine questions, sincere questions, but I don't get into doctrine. People ask me about pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib, pre-Adamite. They ask me a lot of different questions. Then others, I believe they hear something and they don't go and study it and review it. They just, you know, they go back to their traditional learning, but that's okay. The Holy Spirit is teaching all of us, and mine is to do what he asked me to do, do it in love and humility. So that is immersion. And someone had asked, do you have to baptize water baptism in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit? And when I tell you these things, I don't decide what you do, but I do listen to what Jesus has to say. And he said in the word in Matthew 28:19, and I'll take his word over anyone else's opinion. Jesus is recorded as saying, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So that was on water baptism. We'll keep some of these. Okay, so go back to them. But that was, you may recall, the tree that I saw in the vision. And we talked about old trees that thought their time was over. We'll come back to that. The Noah in the cleansing flood we talked about, it was eight of them in the flood. And I referred to Genesis 6, 5, and 11, and 12. And I wanted to mention this one in 1 Peter 3:18-22, which is a direct reference to Noah. If you look at verse 20, and I'll say this, who once were disobedient with the great patience of God was waiting. I'll talk about that waiting in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, which a few, that is eight persons, Noah, his wife, three sons, and three wives, were brought safely through the water. So eight is a new beginning, and you can recall those that have watched the tree branches that he showed me on that particular tree. There were eight of them starting out on a fallen tree. It says that when he patiently waited, it took Noah almost 100 years for he and his family and those to build the ark. There are other parts of whether angels helped him or didn't help him. I'm not going to get into all of that. But the new beginning, and it was a reflection in the New Testament of the Old Testament of a new beginning of the world from the flood. It had destroyed all of those that had committed heinous crimes and against nature of the giants. So that's represented in water baptism, is when you have in your heart a change in your heart, and you ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins. You invite him in to be the Lord of your life, and a change takes place, then what you do in water baptism is you are now changed. You have a new beginning. And so you want publicly to express that. And we do that in water baptism. I also covered at that time the miracle of the new birth. And I'd never heard it taught. But look at it. Those that are from medical, but also understanding when that sac, the water sac breaks at the usually about 99% of the time, other than a C-section, is it's the same time the water breaks, there's a new birth. And the Lord was showing me that there is a new birth when you accept Jesus into your heart and you identify that with water baptism. And he was showing me uniquely that the water sac where the embryo, the baby is formed, it is when it bursts, then there's new life. And so it was one that I had I never heard before because it hadn't been taught. So this was the new beginning that he has shown me. And we'll talk a little bit about that. We're going to talk a lot about it when he allows me to get to that part. But I'll tell you what he did these last few weeks. So this was Noah. So the earth was flooded and cleansed, and out of that came the eight, and then two of a kind of every creeping thing and living thing on earth. Even you remember the dove went out, and then a raven went out. So even had birds that were in there. They couldn't fly, you know, without something to land on for as long as they were in the ark. And then we talk about Jesus approaching John when he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God," and he went down to be baptized. And John, he didn't want to do it. John said, "You should be baptizing me." And Jesus said, "Allow it for this time." And that was, you can look in Matthew 3:16, Mark 1:10, Luke 3:22, and John 1:32. And Matthew 3:13-17 says, "Then Jesus arrived from Galilee at the Jordan, coming to John to be baptized by him. But John tried to prevent him, saying, 'I have need to be baptized by you.' But Jesus answered, said to him, 'Allow it for this time, for in this way it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness.'" And then he allowed him. So we covered that in baptism. And there is another part this past week that I wanted to get into the restoration and refreshing and renewal and a new beginning. And the Lord, we had several nights that were very long in my private time because there are so many questions about Holy Spirit and there's so many questions about the Trinity. He wanted me to further teach on that. But he also told me, "You didn't cover everything in baptism that I have shown you." I said, "Lord, I was trying to, you know, shorten it up a little." And he said, "Take your time. I teach you, and I will draw people to you that are not in a hurry just to hear something, but they want to be taught something." And he taught me, besides the Bereans that are out there, there's more and more that are leaving the itchy ears and realizing that doesn't satisfy. And they're looking for teachers, and it'd be a lot of other teachers, not just but other teachers that are teaching the truth, the meat of the word, so that they can grow and they are more satisfied. Milk satisfies for a while, but as you grow and get older, you need more solid food. So this was another one that I didn't cover, and I'll cover three more. Baptism at the Red Sea. 1 Corinthians 10:1-3. "For I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, that our forefathers walked under the protection by the cloud, in which God's presence went before them. Every one of them passed safely through the Red Sea, and each one of them allowed himself or herself also to be baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. All of them ate the same spiritual, supernatural food and given to them. They said it was angelic bread, angelic food that they were served. I don't think that I covered this, but that was 1 Corinthians 10:1-3. And in the King James Version, that was the Amplified. Moreover, brethren, I would not ye that know ignorant, don't be ignorant, my brethren, how that our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea and were baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea and did all eat the same spiritual meat. So there is, this is the importance of Old Testament connecting with the New Testament and the baptism. The symbolic is like the Lord teaches in parables. And if you, look at Ezekiel or Daniel, a Revelation, there's a lot of symbolism in. But the same thing for as they passed through that sea, it was a sign of baptism. They were not, this was dry ground, but the sea up over it was a picture of immersion. And this is what he had shown me, I don't know how long ago, and I didn't cover this one, but I wanted, here's one that is, I'm going to read some of this, so take notes, please, and review it. And that's why I gave some time to review part one and two. This is, I've talked a lot about the Tabernacle of Moses, and I will teach on that when the Lord allows, and it is an incredible teaching, a lot to do with Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, Father. The bronze laver in the outer court of Moses' temple. This is from my studies with rabbis and Hebrew scholars. Constructed of the mirrors of the Israelite women, the bronze laver represents a believer looking into Scripture as a mirror, seeing himself or herself for who you are and who I am, really our true self, in the light of the high standards of righteousness presented to us by our Messiah, Jesus Christ. Look at James 1:22-25. But prove yourselves doers of the word, not just hearers who deceive themselves. Verse 23, for if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks at his natural face in a mirror. There we're talking about the mirrors again, and I'll get more into that in a minute. Verse 24, for once he or she has looked intently at himself or herself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of person he is. I'm quoting the scripture now. Verse 25, but one who has looked intently at the perfect law, talking about the scripture, the law of freedom, and has continued not in it, not having become a forgetful hearer, but an active doer. So what he's saying, if you look at the word and you ask Holy Spirit to help you fulfill that word, then you're a doer of the word. If you look at the word and walk away from it, he is talking about it as a mirror. I'll read it out and finish out. But prove yourselves doers of the word, not just hearers who deceive themselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks at his natural face in a mirror. For once he has looked at himself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of person he was. But one who has looked intently at the perfect law, the law of freedom, and has continued in it, not having become a forgetful hearer, but an active doer, this person will be blessed in what he or she does. That's the NASB, New American Standard Bible Version. The laver was the font where the priest washed themselves before performing the services of the tabernacle. So I'll show you a picture of that in a minute. The laver represents immersion, and we'll go again with the immersion, or baptism for the remission of sins, Romans 6:3-6, and the washing of the water of the word of Elohim, Ephesians 5:26. We'll come back to that. excuse me, water and the word of Elohim, which are the steps a believer must take after being washed in the blood of Jesus and having one's past sins atoned for after having been first saved. So baptism doesn't save you. It's just a public declaration of what has taken place in your heart, your soul. The second high Sabbath of the Feast of Unleavened Bread is a picture of this ritual, washing or immersion. It was most likely on this day that the children of Israel crossed through the Red Sea and were baptized by Moses, as we covered a minute ago in 1 Corinthians 10:12. So the laver, a bronze laver, but it actually is copper. It was constructed of mirrors of the Israelite women. We'll cover that again in just a second. This was to replicate in this, the sea. And this is what it looked like. The bronze altar was in front of it where they offered sacrifices. This is where they went and you had to climb it, wash themselves and cleanse themselves. I'll cover some of that before they went into the holy place, and they couldn't go into the Holy of Holies. That was on Yom Kippur once a year. So this is what the laver represented. It talks about rabbinic teaching is the baptism. In Exodus 30, 19 through 21, Aaron and his sons are instructed to wash their hands and feet before ministering in the tabernacle so that they do not die. I think that's a pretty strong indication of how the Lord felt about it. If they didn't wash their hands or their feet, they would die. And that's from Exodus 30, verse 19 and 21. Hands and feet represent our actions and our ways for you and for me, my lovely bride and the scholar. Similarly, Jesus washed the feet of his disciples at the Last Supper, John 13, 4 through 11. Thus, ritually, cleansing them for spiritual ministry. So there was a partial reason, if you go back to the tabernacle and the washing, Jesus washed their feet as a servant, as an ox, to show them the humility that he had, but also reflecting for the Jewish people that it was like the laver that you had to wash your hands and your feet. We have covered that a man or woman must be immersed, baptized for the remission of sins, thus identifying with the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, resulting in the newness of spiritual life that comes to each of us as a result thereof. Romans 6, 3 through 14. As noted, the immersion speaks of the washing of the water of the word of Elohim. We'll cover that. Though Jesus, living in and through our actions, our hands and our feet, our way of life, we are being transformed. Remember that word metamorphosis that I had covered when he gave me the dream of the monarch caterpillar and then the monarch butterfly. We are being metamorphosed. We're being changed into the image of Jesus Christ. Exodus 38, 8. We're told how the laver and its bronze was made. He made the laver and its bronze, the base of the bronze, from the mirrors of the women who ministered at the door of the tent of meetings, from the mirrors of the women who ministered at the door. That was quoting both of them, Exodus 38, 8. So he says that the laver was not made of copper from regular contributions. The laver was made exclusively from the brightly polished sheets of copper that women used as mirrors in Egypt. When the call went out for free will contributions, devout women who used to come to Moses' tent and sit at his feet, like Mary did with Jesus, came with their copper mirrors and piled them at Moses' dwelling, which was God's tent of meeting prior to the building of the tabernacle. Exodus 33:7. Moses was said to be reluctant to accept such a gift for God's tabernacle. The story goes, this is rabbinic, that Moses was afraid these mirrors were connected to lust. But God told Moses that he was wrong. because these very mirrors had been instrumental in saving his nation. According to Jewish tradition, in Egypt, when the men came home exhausted every night from their heavy labors, their wives used these mirrors to adorn themselves so they could continue normal marital relations. Thanks to these brightly polished copper mirrors, legions of children were born. I didn't make that up. That's rabbinic tradition that they passed verbally through the years. And when they look at those mirrors that the ladies used, and they gave it and made this copper laver out of it. So like anybody, Moses was reluctant. God said, no. I allowed them so that when their men came home and they were tired and exhausted, they adorned themselves, and as I read the rest of it. God not only told Moses to accept these precious mirrors, but that they were to be used exclusively to fabricate the laver, L-A-V-E-R. Scripture does not specify the size of the laver due to the fact that every single mirror had to go into fashioning it, no matter how big it would become. He used all the mirrors. These mirrors were that sacred in God's eyes. From then on out, these devout women could no longer gaze upon themselves with any vanity in their own mirror. They had to fix their eyes upon the laver to see themselves. One aspect of the copper laver is that it represents bridal lovers fixing their eyes on the author and perfecter of their faith, as well as living water flowing wherever they go and what they do. Talk about the Lord Jesus Christ, Hebrews 12, verse 2. So I didn't make this up. I'm just telling you, Jewish tradition with the laver, it was mirrors. And it refers to mirrors as reflecting the word, which I'll cover. But this was in ministering in the holy place that you had to wash your hands and your feet. And the size of it was symbolic of the Red Sea, where they went through the baptism of Moses. When we look into the water of the word and see our reflection against the standards of righteousness of Christ, we come up short, each one of us. He is the perfect righteous. Nevertheless, when Aaron and the priests washed their washed their bloody hands in the water of the laver, blood and water mingled. Through the blood of Jesus, we measure up in the eyes of our Father, as Paul wrote, 2 Corinthians 5:21. I'm trying to show you the symbolism and how important it is and where it's taken up in the New Testament. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For our sake, he made Christ to be sin who knew no sin, so that in and through him we might become endued, we'll come back to that, endued with, viewed as, the righteousness of God in Christ. When we look at the word through the blood, that is who we are. For Jesus' side came forth blood and water. Remember when they call it the spear of destiny, but when that spear pierced his side, water and blood came out. This points to the bronze laver where blood and water mixed to redeem us from judgment, represented by the bronze. Bronze always represents an iron judgment against our pride and rebellion. Pride is a reference to the mirrors used to make the laver. Blood represents atonement, and water represents both the word of Jesus Christ and the spirit of Elohim. 1 John 5:8, it says, and there are three that bear witness in earth, the spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three are one. Many times in the past when I've taught, people have asked me about that. What does that mean? I'm taking you back to not only the laver, but then Jesus' side with the blood that came out of his side and the water. So go back to the laver, the blood and the water. And in John, he says, these three are one. And they witness in the earth, the spirit, the water, and the blood. Deuteronomy 17:6. On the testimony of two witnesses or three, the condemned shall be put to death. He shall not be put to death only on the testimony of one. what are you saying? And look at Deuteronomy 19:15. So this is Deuteronomy 17:6. He's saying, you have to have the witness of two or three in order to be able to condemn a person to death. And so it was established in the Old Testament that the witness to be truth had to be of two or three. 2 Corinthians 13:1. This is the third time I'm going to come to you on the testimony of two or three witnesses. Every matter shall be confirmed. So this is Paul speaking the same thing that Deuteronomy did in the Old Testament, talking about it has to be confirmed with two or three. So in the Torah or the Pentateuch and the New Testament, which I'd showed you, the Spirit teaches us that every legal matter is to be determined in the mouth of two or three witnesses. Likewise, John, we can view these three as distinct, separate witnesses. Each plays a role in and testifies to man's redemption by the Lord God through Jesus Christ. The blood points to the remission of past sins. Water points to the washing, renewing and cleansing us in the inner man and being conformed to the image of Jesus. And then Jesus Christ, the Word. John 1:14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt. I've taught you that that word dwelt means tabernacle, referring again to the tabernacle in the wilderness. He tabernacled. He set up a tent, a temporary place among us, and we saw his glory, glory as of the only Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. So you see the blood, the water, and the Word. So at the bronze lever, these three elements come together. So that was on a lever, and this is a picture of someone baptized. You know, you can see where they come up, and then they leave, and then someone's in the water. But this is a to show you how the lever, Old Testament with New Testament baptism, you would have to be the Messianic Jews because they believe and we know that our Messiah has come already, Jesus Christ. So that's on the lever. The ecclesia, you and I, we see a reflection of the Lord Jesus Christ in the Word. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. We are washed by the water of the Word. So think of that Word again. Ephesians 5:25-26. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church, the ecclesia, and gave himself for it. I'll cover it in a minute. Verse 26, that he might sanctify and clean it with the washing of water by the Word. That was King James Version. That word it is Greek 8:46, and it means he, she, or it. So it can be both. Himself, it, meaning male and female. Ephesians 5:25-26, the washing of the water of the Word. Titus 3:5, he saved us not because of works done by our righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit. So there we have the Holy Spirit. In reflection. So now you know from the laver, the mirrors that were made. It was made the laver part for mirrors, the bronze below with the bulls. You see, there are 12 of them, three on each side, north, south, east, and west. And that's on, that's another teaching. But the laver part is that you didn't cover that. So I covered that now. Acts 19:6. When Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Spirit came upon them. They began to speak with tongues and prophesying. So now let's move into the Holy Spirit and what Paul had mentioned in Acts 19:6. And John the Baptist had said, you know, I baptized you with water, but he's going to baptize you with fire and the Holy Spirit. So I mentioned in that the picture of the tongues of fire, and the photo was taken in 2005. A team went to Mozambique, Africa, And this was with, it was taken by James Gall, his wife, who had went to be with Jesus in 2008. And so he had reposted this in 2016. Gall and comment, this picture was probably one of the major highlights in Micah Ann's, that's his wife that is with Jesus, travels and ministry that took him around the globe. The photo is not doctored up in any manner. And I talk about that, baptized in fire and the Holy Spirit. And I believe, I take James at his word, for those that can see in the Spirit, this probably is not unfamiliar to you. This is what happens in the Spirit. For those that are filled with the Holy Spirit. And I'll cover a few of these and get into a little bit more. Acts 1:5. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit many days from now. Acts 1:5. Matthew 3:11. John had testified the same of his baptism. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than me, whose sandals I'm not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. That's Matthew 3:11. You can also look at Mark 1:8, Luke 3:16, and John 1:33. Peter and the other apostles had already been born again, but only then were they baptized by the Holy Spirit. John 14:17, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, and that's true today, welcome or take into their heart, because it does not see him or know or recognize him. But you know and recognize him, for he lives with you constantly and will be in you. We'll cover that. John 16:7-8. But I tell you the truth, this is when he was leaving to go back to his father from where he came. But I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I am leaving. For if I do not leave, the helper, counselor, the advocate, the paraclete, will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And he, when he comes, will convict the world regarding sin, and righteousness, and judgment. And in Ephesians 1:13, in him you also have heard the word of truth, the glad tidings of gospel, your salvation, and have believed in and adhered to and relied on him. Talking about you and talking about me, we were stamped, sealed with the seal of the long promised Holy Spirit. Showing you just a, there's a lot of artwork from several centuries ago that just the Holy Spirit coming down. And I had mentioned, and I, this is key for today as we resume. Sealed is the Greek word 4972. So you are, and I am, my bride, my beautiful bride, and Luke, we are sealed. To stamp with a signet or private mark for security or preservation, literally or figuratively. We belong to him. If you read in Romans what Paul said about not being able to be separated from the love of God, not height nor depth, principality, different powers, angels, things past, things to come. Metaphorically, respecting of God, who by the gift of the Holy Spirit indicates who are his. In other words, when you have the Holy Spirit, we're sealed. It says, you belong in the spirit world to me, to God. Ephesians 1:13, Ephesians 4:30, and 2 Corinthians 1:22. So I'm going to cover this again that I had covered so that you can, once again, John 20:21-23. He wanted me to, this is where he said, I don't want you to get to the restoration yet. I want you to talk more as I have taught you about Holy Spirit. I want you to go deeper into it. Take your time. That is how critical Holy Spirit is to me, how Holy Spirit is to you, to my family, and to this lost world, the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, therefore, again to them, peace be to you. As the Father sent me forth, I also send you. Verse 22. And having said this, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you remit, they're remitted. And whose sins you retain, they're retained. That was the time when he breathed on them. Now they had to wait. This is the scripture, Luke 24:49. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. But wait, tarry in Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. So let's talk about that word endued once again so that you have an understanding of it. Endued is the Greek, 1746, is used twice. The sense of sinking into a garment, to invest with clothing, literally or figuratively, to array in clothing. What he's saying, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, your soul and the spirit is going to be endued with power. Power is Greek 1411, and that's dunamis, a force, literally or figuratively, especially miraculous power, implication of miracles itself. And I say from is Greek 1537, talking about the heavenly realm. And then on high is, it's used six times. Greek is 5311, the measure of height in the heavenly realm. Second realm is where principalities and powers, and then the third realm. So let me show this to you as I did before and see if you get it. So he told me to this one. Think of your soul, eternal, with a spirit, small s, spirit of life, this being the Holy Spirit coming and enduing you with power. The Greek of that shows being clothed. So the best I could do is clothing is this little boy with a man's suit on, but that's the way it clothes us fully and completely in our soul. And that Holy Spirit then is just like the curtain was rent in the tabernacle. Now it's soul and Holy Spirit are being able to be jointly together. So again, that's the when the curtain was rent from top to bottom. So this is what he's talking about, being endued with power. Move to this one, without measure. How about the Holy Spirit? John 3:34-36. For whom God sent speaks the word of God. He does not give the Spirit sparingly. It says in measure in King James. What he says is he does not give the Spirit in measure to Jesus Christ, generously and boundlessly. The Father loved the Son and has entrusted all things to his hand. So Jesus is fully immersed in Holy Spirit. Came up, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him as a dove. So let me get started, and I don't know how far we'll get. Jesus, the Anointed One, and I'm going to talk about Holy Spirit, but everything that I do in my heart, because my relationship with him, probably for the last, I don't know how many years, has developed into something different than I never thought would happen. I still wonder why, but I accept it, and he's my friend. And we talk, and he shows me visions. He gives me prophetic words for America, the great eagle. But and I'm going to spell something, because those that follow me know how I can do some of these words. Yeshua, Y-E-S-H-U-A, spelling of another word, H-A-M-A-S-H-I-A-C-H, Yeshua HaMashiach. Yeshua HaMashiach is Hebrew for Jesus the Messiah. Yeshua is a shortened version of the name Y-E-H-O-S-H-U-A, Yeshua, which means Adonai saves. Adonai is Lord God. Meshach is the Hebrew word for Messiah and means anointed one. So we're talking about the anointed one, Yeshua HaMashiach, and there are many that write me and sign off with that. Old Covenant scriptures speak of the coming Messiah who would be God's anointed one to deliver Israel and all mankind. Most Jewish people living at the time of Jesus believe the Messiah would physically save them from their oppression under Roman rule. They did not recognize that the prophets foretold a much greater freedom, and that's for us today, true. Israel has had many enemies over the millennia, but none so dangerous as the ones we seek to keep from recognizing God's sole provision for eternal reconciliation to himself. That Jesus has come, and he is the lamb that was sacrificed. Satan prowls and roars and steals and attacks and accuses. 1 Peter 5:8, John 10:10, Ephesians 6:16, Revelation 12:10. 1 Peter 5:8, John 10:10, Ephesians 6:16, and Revelation 12:10. Does everything in his power to mislead, to blind, confuse, and distract, particularly my Jewish friends, from the Messiah. While the Jewish people look for a Savior to physically free them from bondage to Rome, God sent Yeshua HaMashiach to spiritually save us from bondage of sin and offering us eternal spiritual freedom, eternal life. We are within us eternal. This body is not. It will return, as the Bible says, dust to dust. So let me talk about the Holy Spirit. I always with Jesus. If Jesus is my friend, you have to be intimate and know Holy Spirit. And this I will put in the thing. The word Rosh appears for the first time in Genesis 1:2. Says, and the Spirit of God identifies it as that way. The word also means wind. The word Kodesh, K-O-D-E-S-H, comes from the word Kodash, K-A-D-O-S-H. That means holy. That root, R-U-A-C-H, H-A-K-O-D-E-S-H, is in the Old Testament is mentioned 23 times as the Spirit, but in a different form, the Spirit of God, R-U-A-C-H, Adonai. So we are talking, as I had mentioned before, Rock, R-U-A-C-H-H-A-K-O-D-E-S-H, Holy Spirit. So what the Lord wanted me to share and begin on is the mysteries of the truth revealed by Holy Spirit. He seems to be the mystery, the mysterious part of the Trinity. We have been taught on Jesus not much about God the Father, but even less on the Holy Spirit. He's seldom mentioned today. The word Holy Ghost is not mentioned. Being endued with power is not mentioned. Speaking in a different prayer language. And if you don't have a prayer language, that doesn't mean you're not saved. You're just as saved as anyone else. So that'll be another time. But don't let Satan or others tell you otherwise. You are a born-again child of God. The word mystery or mysteries So it doesn't sound like I'm coming up with something. This is in the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Hebrew is 73:28, and the Greek is 34:66. A hidden or secret, that's the word for Hebrews. It's used nine times. They use that word secret rather than mystery. Thing not obvious to the understanding, a hidden purpose or counsel, the secret will of God. Secret counsels which govern God in dealing with the righteous, which are hidden from ungodly and wicked men and women, but plain to the godly in the scripture. So it denotes mystic or hidden sense of the Old Testament. So to let you know that's in the Word, look at Daniel 2:28, and then I'll read Daniel 4:9. Daniel 2:28. However, there is a God in heaven who reveals, this is Daniel speaking to Nebuchadnezzar, there's a God in heaven who reveals mysteries, would be secret, and he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will take place in the latter days. This was your dream and the visions of your mind while you lay in bed. Daniel 4:9. Belteshazzar, chief of the magicians, since I know that a spirit of the holy gods is in you and no mystery baffles you, tell me the visions of my dream. Old Testament. Well, let's look at the New Testament. Matthew 3:11. And this one is when Jesus speaks, and it's when he speaks, that's truth. I go to the original context, but it's truth when Jesus speaks. I used to have a Bible that I always had read when he spoke, and I love the Bible. That's the one my schnauzer ate part of it. Jesus answered them. I was discouraged. I woke up, I'd tell you, I laying on the floor reading that Bible, and my schnauzer, miniature schnauzer, just like a child to me. Well, the kid I had at the time, I did. She ate part of the word of the Bible. I'm like, I couldn't believe it. And the Lord has a sense of humor. So don't write me, please. He told me, he said, she's chewing on the word. Now she's got the word in her. It still bummed me out, but it was his sense of humor. So Matthew 3:11. Jesus answered them, to you it has been granted to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them, talking about the others, it has not been granted. So Jesus refers to that, and that's the Greek word, mysteries, Mark 4:11. And he was saying to them, to you has been given the mystery of the kingdom of God, but those who are outside get everything in parables. I speak often in parables so that the Holy Spirit can reveal what he's saying to you, but those that monitor me, and there's so many, not only in the intelligence community, you know, there's 17 agencies in the intelligence community, but also from different platforms. Luke 8:10. And he said, to you it has been granted to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to the rest it is in parables, so that seeing they may not see, and hearing they may not understand. Two more. Ephesians 3:8-9. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this is the way that I feel, God's consecrated people, you, this grace, the favor or the privilege, was granted and graciously entrusted to proclaim to the Gentiles the unending, that word is boundless and not exhausted. So it's just boundless, it's over and over and over. Riches of Christ, wealth which no human could have known in their soul, and they could not have searched out in the natural. Also to enlighten all men and make plain to them what is the plan regarding the Gentiles, the salvation for them and for all men, of the mystery kept hidden through the ages and concealed until now in the mind of God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. In him was all things made, Jesus Christ. So Paul is saying, this was kept as a mystery, a hidden secret from Old Testament prophets, and I am the one to reveal it. And he was beaten, he was stoned, he was thrown in jail, ridiculed, ostracized because he challenged the doctrine of the day. The doctrine was it was for the Jews only. And Paul received the revelation from Jesus himself and said, no, it's for the Gentiles. And it took a long time, and the Lord God, through the Holy Spirit, showing Peter and others visions and them going to pray for Gentiles and them being miraculously baptized and then filled with the Holy Spirit until they accepted it. But he went through so much because he was teaching something that was different from what the tradition had taught, different doctrine. Romans 16:25. Now to him who is able to establish you according to my gospel and the preachings of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery which has been kept secret for long ages past. Romans 16:25. So now let's start in on the Holy Spirit. And I've shown this to you before. Third person of the Trinity, R-U-A-C-H, capital H-A, capital K-O-D-E-S-H, Rosh HaKodesh. The force be with you. Holy Spirit is portrayed by Hollywood as a mysterious force of the Jedi, or a power wielded by releasing the mind to the realm of the spirit. In paranormal activity, he is often confused as a ghost or immaterial substance. I can remember when I was growing up, there was a show, Casper the Ghost, and I think many people think Casper the Ghost. I assure you, the Holy Spirit is a person. He's the third person of the Trinity. By and large, in structure religion, the structured church, not the remnant, the ecclesia, not those that teach the truth. He is an invisible spirit who is ignored or only mentioned in conjunction with the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit during baptism. Without instruction from Scripture, too many Christians have no idea who he is or how he works in our life. So the question that came to many that asked me over the years, not just one, they would say, does it matter? And so the Lord said, I want you to address that and take your time and say, yes, it does matter. Yes, it matters as he. The Holy Spirit is the third person in the Trinity. Though distinct from one another in relationship to the natural, the physical, and spiritual dimensions and manifestations, they are equal in the Godhead. So we'll cover a few of the attributes of Holy Spirit to gain a better understanding. This is what he has taught me, and this is what I am will try to teach you as best I can. It's not you, it's me. So Revelation 1:4-5. John to the seven churches that are in Asia. Grace to you and peace from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne. Verse 5, and from Jesus Christ the faithful, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Revelation 1:4-5. Seven spirits that are before his throne. Revelation 3:1, church in Sardis. He who has the seven spirits, sevenfold fullness of Holy Spirit is what that is, but he who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars says this, I know your deeds, that you have a name, that you are alive, and yet you are dead. So he's mentioned seven spirits, and the seven spirits were before the throne. Revelation 4:5. Out from the throne came flashes of lightning and rumbling and peals of thunder. And in front of the throne, seven blazing torches burned, which are the seven spirits of God, the sevenfold Holy Spirit, sevenfold Holy Spirit. So when you see that, people have said that's seven angels. There are seven archangels, and they each have a distinct, they call it in those terms, vocation, what they do. They're legions or myriads that are beneath them. So let me explain that a little further so we're clear on the seven spirits. The seven lamps of fire. Remember, I said there are seven torches, is what it means, seven lamps of fire. Daniel 10, 4 through 6. This is not milk, this is meat. Please take notes and please review it again. Daniel 10, 4 through 6. On the 24th day of the first month, while I was by the bank of the great river, that is the Tigris, verse 5, I raised my eyes and looked, and behold, there was a man dressed in linen, whose waist had a belt of pure gold, of UPHAZ. UPHAZ, that city was known for its wealth in gold. So a man dressed in linen, whose waist had a belt of pure gold of that city. His body was also like beryl. Beryl is the Hebrew, 8658 is gold colored. So he mentioned a golden belt in that was on this, in the vision he saw. His face had the appearance of lightning. His eyes were like flaming torches. His arms and feet like the gleam of polished bronze, and the sound of his words like the sound of a multitude. So you can see what Daniel says is that those flaming torches, and it's the same in Revelation 4 or 5, it says seven blazing torches. One is blazing, one is flaming. So the eyes of this person that John was looking at, he identified him as Jesus Christ, the Messiah. Eyes of the Lord. So that's the seven lamps of fire. Seven lamps of fire in Daniel. Eyes of the Lord. Revelation 5, 6. And behold, and lo, in the midst of the throne, and the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. Seven spirits of God, that is in the Holy Spirit, and I'll show you the omnipresence of the Holy Spirit. Zechariah, go back to the Old Testament, 3:9. For behold, upon this stone, the rock, Jesus Christ, which I have set before Joshua, upon that one stone are seven eyes or facets, the all-embracing providence of God, and the sevenfold radiations of the Spirit of God is in the original. Behold, I will carve upon its inscription, says the Lord of hosts, and I will remove the iniquity and guilt of the land in a single day. So he's saying upon that stone, that rock, are seven eyes or seven facets, the sevenfold radiation of the Spirit of God. So that's the eyes of the Lord. We covered seven lamps of fire, eyes of the Lord in relationship to Holy Spirit. Look at Zechariah 4:10. Who despises the day of small things? For these seven shall rejoice when they see the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel. The seven are the eyes of the Lord roaming throughout the earth, that omnipresence. And the Holy Spirit is omnipresent. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, omnipresent. Look at 2 Chronicles 16:9. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose hearts are blameless towards him. So in Chronicles, it said the eyes of the Lord to and fro throughout the earth. It just said the seven eyes in Zechariah are the eyes of the Lord roaming, God the Father. Holy Spirit will testify of Jesus Christ. John 15, 26. When the Comforter comes, whom I will send to you from my Father, namely the Spirit of truth, who comes from the Father, he will testify of me. So it is talking about the testimony of the Holy Spirit of Jesus Christ. And it is that Holy Spirit moving upon us to know him, to have an intimacy with him, to acknowledge him, to worship him, and to praise him as he is due. John 16, 13, 14. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own, but whatever he hears, he will speak. And he will disclose to you what is to come. He will glorify me, talking about Jesus. For he, Holy Spirit, will take from mine and will disclose it to you. So there's a function of the Holy Spirit that today, for you and for me, for my beautiful bride, and for Luke and his generation, the Holy Spirit is sent to us to teach us and to bring to remembrance the things that we have been taught, but also to show us what is to take place in the future. And that's more in the realm of the prophetic gift, but this is what John said under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. But when the Spirit comes, he will guide you into all truth. And Jesus is the truth. The word is truth. He will not speak on his own. He will disclose to you what is to come. So don't say Jim said that. This is what the scriptures say. So let me mention these and then we'll probably pick it up the next time. Seven attributes of the Holy Spirit are identified in Isaiah. Now, this is of the Holy Spirit. So the mystery of the Holy Spirit, one that is seldom talked about, the Lord Jesus Christ has asked me to share as much as I can about Holy Spirit. Going back to Old Testament, Hebrew, and I know that many of the things will challenge because we just haven't been taught on the Holy Spirit. When I say that, go back to Scripture. If it's not in Hebrew, the original text, there's two Hebrews. There's the biblical Hebrew, and then there's the new Hebrew. So there's two different Hebrew wording for the Old Testament. Biblical Old Testament, and then the modern Hebrew. So go back to Hebrew, or if it was Chaldean or Aramaic, some are translated from Latin. New Testament is Greek, and I have taught on Greek that it's limited often in what it has the word's definition. I gave you an example a few months ago of the word love, and the three different translations for the word love. And I gave you the example of Peter when he was talking with Jesus, and Jesus asked him if he loved him. So the seven attributes of Holy Spirit, Isaiah 11, 1 through 2. And there shall come forth a shoot out of the stock of Jesse, David's father, and a branch out of his roots shall grow and bear fruit. This is, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, Jesus Christ. The Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the reverential, R-E-V-E-R-E-N-T-I-L, reverential, and obedient fear of the Lord. So these are the seven attributes of Holy Spirit. All, I read you the scripture that Jesus was given the Holy Spirit without measure. It was boundless. So if you write these down, and I'll cover, I have scriptures for each one of these, and this is probably where we'll pick up next time. The first is the Spirit of the Lord, Spirit of wisdom. That's number two, Spirit of wisdom. Third is Spirit of understanding. The fourth is the Spirit of counsel. Fifth is the Spirit of might. Six, the Spirit of knowledge. And seventh is the Spirit of fear. What that word fear is, a reverence for, a reverential fear for God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. These are the seven attributes. Remember, I covered before the throne, the seven torches, the seven eyes. And these are in Jesus Christ. And when he received the Holy Spirit, he was endued with all of these attributes of Holy Spirit. I have for each one of these, we will talk about the scriptures that confirm those and how he is treated as equal to God the Father. He's called the Spirit of God, considered God. He is called God. He's eternal. He is self-existent. He's omnipresent. He's omniscient. Here's another one for you. O-M-N-I-S-C-I-E-N-T. Omnipotent. That means he's all-knowing. Omnipresent means he's everywhere. David said, if I, you know, the highest heavens, down in the Sheol, you're there. He is sovereign. He was involved in the creation. He enabled the writing of the Bible. He helps us to recognize the glory of God. And he enables us to call upon the Lord. So I have scriptures for all those. And then I also have a part that I appreciate and I have studied for years. Some of the ministers from the past, John Wesley and Smith Wigglesworth, and one of them is Charles Spurgeon. Charles Spurgeon was from 1834 to 1892. And so I like to take our history of what the Holy Spirit has revealed and show that it's the same truth then to some of those men as it is today. And so I'll cover some of the attributes that Spurgeon talked about at that time. And then lastly of that, I will get into the personality of the Holy Spirit. He has a personality. He can be grieved. And I believe many are familiar with that one, and I'll cover other things. So that is the beginning on Holy Spirit. I hope and pray that this is something the Lord wanted me to teach and to take my time and to go into. We'll talk about that again on next broadcast. And then when he allows me, I'll wrap up with the vision of the promise of God the Father, excuse me, to restore and refresh for this year, 2022. So thank you. I want to mention a few things. Some of the things that have been on my heart for praying are still the ranchers and the farmers. We see prices going up. And there's one that I wrote down in my book downstairs, goat cheese. I had a little goat. There is a Christian business that makes a lot of products out of goat cheese. And I don't know that I've ever tasted goat cheese, but they make a lot of product out of that. I know it's pretty prevalent in the Old Testament and in other parts of the world with goats. The other was there are several people going to surgeries, difficult surgeries. And so we have prayed for doctors to have wisdom, to have anointed hands, and to be able to have successful surgeries when those are required. Many that have written, and I understand this more than most, those that are not working and those that have not had a job in a long time. I won't go into all of it, maybe another time. I was blackballed in 2015. I was considered a subject matter expert at the time, probably still am. I have a secret clearance on Homeland Security, ports and harbors. And then I worked with TSA with canines, but also over the years with the Israeli Defense Force and others, many of the others. So I think that's probably why some of the intelligence agencies watch me. But those that are looking for employment, not just to have a job, but one that they enjoy, many want just a job. And I pray for that. And I pray that it would be a job they really like. There's so few people that have jobs that they look forward to go to and they get excited about. So many have written in prayer for a loved one, a friend, and even themselves, praying that that they're part-time, that they would be brought on full-time so they can have the benefits. So they're just those things that, you know, I've told you before, I asked the Lord at night, you know, what's on your mind and you know, how are you feeling? And people, it doesn't matter whether you believe it or not, it doesn't matter to me. And he'll tell me. And there's certain things at night, certain parts of the world, regardless of how you feel of what's taking place in Ukraine. Strangely enough, he had me pray about a particular bird that was being acquired. And I prayed, I could have told you the outcome. I prayed a lot on that until I felt peace about it. Same thing for other Taiwan. It's on my heart. It's on the Lord's heart. We saw what happened in Ukraine, and Red Dragon is waiting. It wants it. So, and then also the dwarf, the Hermit Kingdom. So many of you are on my heart as it is. I ask the Lord, and you're on his heart. And so I pray. My beautiful bride prays, Luke prays. We do our best to honor what you send in and bring it before the Lord. All we can do is bring it before him and cry out passionately to him. So I do pray, and Kimberly and Luke, we pray for you individually. We pray for your families. We have prayed a lot for prodigals, that they would come back. Many of the children that have been caught up in this education, critical race theory, and parents, school boards, and unions, a lot of prayer for that and fasting. And then for this great nation, the United States of America. So thank you again. And like I said, please go back and read the words, study the words, and let Holy Spirit speak to you. Don't let your tradition or your doctrine or your favorite thing that you like, because you could miss something. If the Holy Spirit does not bear witness, then put it aside. I did the same thing with the Eucharist. I gave facts on it, and yet people wrote me and said they still believe that the Eucharist is transformed into flesh of Christ. That's between you and God. All I can do is give you what I've studied and present it to you. I don't try to make your mind up for you. That's between you and God. And people have asked me the same thing about baptism. Do I have to be rebaptized because I taught on baptism? That's not my point. In teaching on baptism, my point is to give you the facts and give you the truth, and that's a decision between you and God. You know, your heart is right with God, then you know that's between you and him. So thank you, and I appreciate your time. I love you in Christ, and I'll see you the next broadcast.